Hey guys, as I said, if we reach the Twitch sub goal, I will be making a Resource Shaman guide for 9.1, and here we are. I'm gonna try to explain everything as better as I can. You guys know my English is not the greatest, so I will try to go slowly but surely. Okay, boys. Okay. First of all, we're gonna start talking about the racials for Rest of Shaman on 9.1. Before 9.1, I think like Orc racial. I think it was the best by far. There was not even close. But right now, 9.1, they added this new PvP trinket. The Sackle, okay, is like the BFA Maledict that absorbs and do damage at the same time while it's channeling. And because of this trinket, Dwarf, the normal Dwarf or Dark Iron Dwarf, is actually really good race to play a Resto Shaman, but not into everything. Anyway, I can tell you into what is the best. I think overall Orc is the best still. Because all this high burst damage, they will kill you in a stun if you're normal Dwarf or you're Dark Iron Dwarf. Because, how is it called? The passive hardiness. Duration of stun effects reduced by an additional 20%. This is really, really, really broken. And it makes you almost immortal during the stuns. Unless, like, you face a red paladin, you face a mage with a rogue, they pop every single cooldown and you don't have anything or your teammates are not gonna peel you, then yeah, you will die through anyway. But this is like really, really huge passive right now that makes Orcs like the best race for Resto Shaman. But you can still play like Dwarf or normal Dark Iron Dwarf. I mean, normal Dwarf or Dark Iron Dwarf. Into one match, I like to play like Dwarf. For example, into jungle, let's say I play like the last weekend I played the Arena World Championship into jungle and we all play Dwarf or Dark Iron Dwarf. Why? Because the red can get me out of stuns, the water can intervene with the stuns, so kinda don't need hardiness at all, because there is always a button to press during while I'm in a stun. And after a stun, with the Dwarf racial or Dark Iron Dwarf racial, you can remove Maledicts, you can remove Bleeds, you can remove anything, you know? So, yeah, I think that's the only matchup where I will say like Dwarf is like better than Orc, but it's not that bad racial. But I think Orc is just better overall, okay? So, yeah. Let's move into the next one, next step. Talents and PvP talents depending on comps, okay. So the normal, I'm gonna start with the PvE talents, the normal talents. Okay, Torrent versus Undulation versus Unleash Life. I tested all of them, and overall, Unleash Life is just way better than any other. Undulation is really bad, because Resto Shaman right now, I mean, Undulation could get some value into like double melee comps, because you are kinda casting a lot, you know, because there is like high consistent damage, but overall I think this life is just better because it gives you like insta healing and as well it buffs your next direct heal as well by 35%. Torrent is just good for the insta healing, but anyway you don't need this 20% extra when you can have like a 35 extra plus the initial healing that the Unleashed Life does. So overall Unleashed Life is just way better than any other than the other two. Here, there is no doubt about it that Echo of the Elements is just way better than any other talent. Deluge and Search of Earth, you cannot even think of picking them because like getting two Riptide stacks, two Lava Burst stacks, two Healing Sim stacks is just too good to replace them. Because, I mean, Riptide heals a lot right now, and Healing Stream, you have a conduit for it that we'll talk later about it. Surely in current, so yeah, there is no doubt about it. I think in PvP, you play 99% of the games, you play Airgraph Totem. I think it's really good talent. You can stop so many ghosts with this, like you can root Beam Hunter pets, you can root Windwalker pets, can double root melees. You can get in combat with them, you can stop drinks, you can do so many things with this. Like, you can root a rock during a go. I think it's just mandatory. I actually play Spirit Wolf once in one matchup in 2v2. For example, when I'm facing like Holy Paladin with a DK, Frost DK, unless I'm playing Rosh Hashanah with a melee, let's say a Warrior or a Windwalker or whatever, I kinda don't need roots because the DK can get out of the roots every 45 seconds with the sprint, and the Palag has double freedom as well. So roots gets, you don't get value from them at all. So I just play Spirit Wolf plus Spectral Recovery into that, so I just get max value from it. But yeah, normally you kinda don't play it. Between these three talents, you never play Ancestral Protection Totem, the Rest Totem. It's just people, if the enemy that you're facing are a bit smart, they will kill the totem. It has no, I think it has like 5k HP, I believe, maybe a bit less, I don't remember now. Erden is not that good, it's not as good as it was back in the days, because every class just do big hits, like Red can do 20k to 30k hits, same with Warriors. Mage does like 10k Pyroblast non-stop, you know, like this kind of classes. So, I mean, Erden Wall Totem is like good, let's say, into like Ferals, because of the bleed damage, like it's not high hits, so it gets value from it. Like into classes that don't do high hits. But anyway, I think it's just the best pick overall. But I think Ancestral Vigor is actually still really good, but not as a talent. I will explain you how I use Ancestral Vigor, okay? So, I don't know if you guys know how Fleshcraft works, okay? So, Fleshcraft says, form a shield of flesh and bone over 3 seconds that absorbs damage equal to 40% of your maximum HP for 2 minutes. So, it's HP based, okay? So, what I do before the arena starts, I pick Ancestral Vigor, I hot myself, and then I Fleshcraft. So, I have 10% more HP. 10% is not that much, but I mean, it matters a bit on like the top level games to get a maximum shield sometimes. So this is a little tip that you guys can have. That's what I do, and I think it's not that bad at all, but yeah, let's move on. The next talent between Nature's Guardian, Graceful Spirit and Windrush Totem. I never ever play Windrush Totem. I think it's a really bad talent to pick. Because it's just as is. If it was a freedom, sure, but it's not a freedom at all. So it's just an sprint. So you can instantly slow the guy after he gets the sprint. If it was a freedom, it would be really, really good, but it's not. So overall, you will play Natus Guardian. That when you drop below 35% HP, you get an insta heal for 20% of your HP, and it can only happen every 45 seconds. And that's why I have this weak aura. That once they proc Nature's Guardian, I will have a timer here, okay? And this is really important because let's say you are facing rogue mage. Let's say they don't have any city, because with cities they will kill you no matter what, even if you have it or not. But let's say they don't have cities and they want to make a go on you anyway. You have the passive, you are probably gonna be fine because you will get 20% more. A 20% HP heal when you drop below 35%. So that's why I track it and been tracking it for so long, and it's really helpful. So yeah, I think Nature's Guardian is the best overall. People ask me a lot, why do you play this into Disc Sabrok in choose because of the mind games, blah blah blah. I mean, yeah, that's true, but in a normal matchup, if you get stunned by the rogue into mind games, that means or your positioning is bad because you're in the middle of the map, or because your DPS is kinda AFK and it's not helping you. So yeah, it's situational though. I play it like into everything, to be honest. I rarely play Graceful Spirit. But I sometimes play it. Like for example, if I face jungle is Hunter Feral Disc. If I face jungle, for example, and let's say I'm playing like SP Water Rest of Shaman, it's gonna be really weird that the jungle hits me. So I kinda play Graceful Spirit to get a short aura mastery combined with this, with Ancestral Gift, so I have 1 minute aura mastery. And that's really, really, it helps so much, actually. But yeah, I don't play it. Like, if you are scared of getting Mangens and die from Natus Guardian, you gotta deal with it. Like, you need to... First of all, you should not get mind games unless your team is kinda FK. And if the enemy team is like 3 versus 1 because they CC your 1 DPS and the other, it's probably gonna be your trinket anyway. So, yeah. And the thing is, like, even if you are playing Graceful Spirit and they do a 3 versus 1 on you, you're gonna have to trinket anyway because it's 3 versus 1, you will die probably 2 times in a row. Even if you're playing this or you're not playing that. Let's say you're facing Rogue Mage and you're playing Natus Guardian. If it's 3 versus 1, you're gonna die no matter what. Let's say you're playing Graceful Spirit. You're playing... If the RMP is 3 versus 1 because this is your Warrior, they're your Red, your SP, whatever they come you're playing. They're gonna kill you anyway. Even if you're playing Graceful Spirit or even you're playing Natus Guardian. So... It doesn't matter that much right now. Maybe with higher item level, like we have in the tournament server, maybe it will matter, but for now, I tested and it doesn't matter anyway. If it's 3 versus 1 situation, or 2 versus 1 in 2v2, it doesn't matter. You don't want to die anyway, playing with it or without it. So, I kinda will take Natus Guardian always, because outside of a mind games go, this talent helps a lot. It really does. So overall, I will play Natus Guardian and in specific situations where you know you're not gonna get hit. Like, let's say you're playing double caster into jungle, so you play this, it's really good. Or you're playing water SP into jungle, so you can pick it. When I play double melee, I kinda don't play it, because they can... If they see I aura mastery 2 times 1 minute into the game, and if they're a bit smart, they will try to go me because I'm not playing this. And I will be a bit squishy, so yeah. Okay, let's move on. Here, there is no doubt Flash Flood is the best option in this row. So, yeah. I mean, this one is just really good because you get a speed on your next cast after you consume a Tidal Wave's stack. It's really, really good. I actually like it. I kinda combine it with Healing Surge on this meta because the pathing of the game is really, really fast right now, so there is no time to cast Healing Waves. Maybe sometimes you do, but overall you just go for a Healing Surge normally. But yeah. And then the last one, of course, is Ascendance. Ascendance is just really, really, really broken a cooldown, especially if they're going you, for example. I spent it so many times on my stream, but I'm gonna do it again here, it's fine. So let's say I'm low HP, let's hope I don't die here. Good. So I'm low HP, okay? Let's say my teammates, this is a pillar, let's say my teammates are behind the pillar and they're training me. So if I Ascendance here on my partner's line, if I Ascendance, the healing will get the split, you know? But if I line everyone else, all my teammates, and I Ascendance, all the healing will be on myself, the first stick. So I will top myself no matter what. Even if I have one Malady, I will probably top myself to full HP. And that's the broken thing about Ascendance. And let's say you want to do it on your partner, so your full HP. Your full HP. Your full HP and you want to heal your teammates, all the healing will be on them because you are already top. So yeah, it will depend on the missing HP from everyone. So because the healing will get split a little bit. Okay, and let's move on now with PvP talents. I guess it depends what combo you play, but overall, Living Tide is just the best talent you have right now. The best PvP talent you have is really, really strong, like super strong. With the new buff on 9.1, Healing Tide. Cooldown is reduced by 1.5 minutes, it was 3 minutes. It heals for 100 more each time it pulls. So that means Healing Tide has 7 pulses, or pulls, I don't know how to pronounce it. And then every single pulse it does, it will get doubled almost. It will be healed 100% more compared to the last one, as you can see. 5.6k into 6.4, you know. And this scales with mastery as well. So if your partner is low HP And healing tide is ticking, you will heal more and more and more and more. And he is an AoE heal. AoE heal, and I believe he has 40 yards range. Yeah. So you can like place it behind the pillar. And if your team is at 40 yards range, you will heal them no matter what. And it's probably one of the, your strongest cities right now. So good teams will try to kill them. So it's really good. We will talk later on about the totem positioning and placement, because it's really important how to position your totems. I have a clip even on how do I place my healing tide totem just to avoid the enemy team to kill it, and I actually countered a whole go with it. So I will show you later. Okay, let's move on. Grounding totem, I kinda play 99% of the games. I think it's really good, even now with the new Maledic trinket, the cycle trinket, that you can, even if they already channeling the trinket, you can ground it mid cast as well. It won't remove the absorb they already did, but it will stop it unless they kill the grounding again. So you can ground this Maledic trinket. You can ground it mid cast. You can ground it instantly, or you can ground it late. So ground is just like too powerful right now into everything, into almost every class. More PvP talents, Sky Fury. I don't play that much anymore, because like other talents are just way too good. You can play, maybe you play with a red, you know. Let's say you're playing red warrior, you're playing with a Necrolord warrior, Kyrian red. And you just want to do the biggest pop every 2 minutes with Necrolord Banner and the wings plus a Sky Fury totem. Like, you can do big damage with it, but overall it's not that great, because people just press CDs on your red wings. Maybe you're playing some double caster like SP Boomy, LL Lock, I don't know. Some LL Boomy, SP Boomy, I don't know, some comments like this. Maybe Sky Fury is good, but with the comments that I play SP Water, Red Water, I don't recommend it. So yeah, Counter Strike is useless, Swelling Waves is not good. There is better talent, Sword Hex. It could be good, but I don't use it that much right now. Like, any other talents are just better. You will use it in like some specific matchups probably, but I can't tell you which one right now. Like, let's say you're playing versus a Turbo. Turbo is Shaman Enhancement, Warrior, and a Healer, normally Holy Paladin. And you just want to like drag the game to Dampening and try to win there, because you cannot win before Dampening. So you just want to spam Hex the Shaman. That's actually the only situation where I could think of Voodoo Mastery having value. So let's move on. Electrocute, I kinda use it to troll in 2v2, but it does no damage. Is the most useless talent ever. He was so good back in Legion, I believe he was. But right now, he does no damage at all. It would be really funny if they buffed, but he does no damage right now. Tidebringer, he was really, really good in BFA, but right now, he does nothing. With all the chain heal nerfs and everything, he does no healing right now. Spectral Recovery. For now, I don't think it's worth to play it. Like, you don't have the time to sit in Ghost Wolf and get healed for 30% of your HP every 2 seconds. There is no time, because the damage is just too high. So even if he gives you movement speed on your Ghost Wolf, it's not even worth. Like, you have no time to like spend time in Ghost Wolf these days. Cleansing Waters, the healing rain dispel that I call. I kinda played a lot into Rogue Mage when I play, like, I'm playing SP Warrior Resto Shaman, and I kinda played a lot into Rogue Mage. How do I play it? I try to like, or healing rain one of my DPSs to get out of CC, or I healing rain myself before, let's say, the mage is gonna blink Dragon Breath me into ship, or I'm gonna get a fear, or I know like my guy is gonna get bombed, so I just healing rain him to dispel these trinkets. Dispel this trinket, because it dispels everything, the healing rain if it crits. So yeah, I kinda play into Rogue Mage, because you can do so many plays with it. Will I recommend it for a guy that is not play, that doesn't have too much experience on Shaman? Probably not. Because playing with an Ancestral Gift is really, really fucking aids. Sometimes But if you want to try it out, it's actually a good pick as well. Into rock mage, I would play like or Ancestral Gift or Cleansing Waters, both are really good. But into like good rock mages, you kinda need Cleansing Waters because otherwise it's really hard to win. So yeah, it's both are really good talents, and doesn't matter which ones you play, you want to like make some plays and pre-dispel your ship, pre-dispel your Dragon Breath, your Fear, if it crits, if your Healing Rain crits on top of you, of course. Or you want to like Healing Rain your DPS to dispel him out of CC or out of a Maledict Trinket. You can try it. It's not that bad talent. The problem is like people that have not that much experience on Shaman, they might get kicked a lot with while casting Healing Rain, and that will make the game a bit harder to play because you're getting kick on cooldown on Healing Rain and they're making a go after it, you know. So yeah, for now I will recommend you Ancestral Gift more over Cleansing Waters, because yeah, as I said, you can get kick on it and then they can make a go after it, you know, and there is more CC and more CC, you know. Ancestral Gift is just really good. You combine it with Graceful Spirit, it's even better, but as I said before, I mean, it depends when you play one of these two, you know. Ancestral Gift, you just become immune to silence and interrupt effects for 5 seconds after using Spirit Walker Grace. Yeah, that's all. So you cannot get kick or silence during the 5 seconds that they last. And the new PvP talent that they implemented on 9.1, Unleash Shield. This talent is really, really insane, and at the same time, it's really, really ace to get value from it. I believe I will have some clips later, yes, how to use Unleash Shield, that I will show later. But I mean, you can use it in a different ways, okay? So I'm just gonna show it quick here on the Doomies. So the first one I'm gonna use the Lightning Shield, okay? Lightning Shield, you need to have Lightning Shield up, and then you will press Unleash Shield, boom. It's immune, but I mean, you will knock him away, so you will get knocked. It's a 20-yard range, I believe it is, yes. So you kinda need to be like not too far away. The problem of this talent is just the range. If the range was like 30 yards or more, this talent will be so, so good. But the problem is you need to be close. And you being close to your enemies means that you're gonna get CC, you're gonna get kicks, you're gonna get grip from a DK into a go. You're gonna get 8, okay? That's the only problem that I see with this talent. But overall, this talent, you kinda use it with the Water Shield effect. Summons a Whirlpool for 6 seconds, reducing damage and healing by 50% while they stand on it, okay? So this is like a Serpent Blade. So I will place the pool here. Damage and healing reduced by 50%. The damage that this guy is gonna do to anyone is gonna be reduced by 50%, and the healing this guy is gonna do to himself and other people is gonna be reduced 50%. Okay, I wanna explain this because people don't understand. Let's say I'm facing let's put a 2v2 example, okay? Let's say I'm facing priest rogue in 2v2, disc priest rogue in 2v2, okay? If I pull the rogue, let's say this guy is the rogue and this guy is the priest. So this guy with the skull mark is the rogue, and this guy with the star mark is the priest, okay? So if I pull this rogue, this guy's gonna do 50% damage, but this guy's gonna do 50% less healing on everyone. But the rogue doesn't heal, you know what I mean? So all the healing the priest will do to the rogue is not gonna get affected by the pull. Okay? It's only the healing on the guy that has the pull on top of him. You know what I mean? I don't know if I explained it correctly. But for example, if I put the pull on the priest, this guy is the priest, as I said, the healer. So all the healing this guy will do, he will get affected by 50%. That's what I tried to say. So it only affects to himself and all the healing that guy does to anyone else. So it kinda doesn't work like Serpent Blade from Warrior, because if this guy's the rogue and I Serpent Blade this guy with the Serpent from Warrior, it will affect even the healing the other guy does, even if the priest doesn't have the Serpent on himself. You know, so if I sharpen the rogue again, the priest will heal him normally. I mean, right now, no, because he's in the pool, obviously, but you know what I mean? If he's not on the pool, it will heal him like nothing is happening. I think I explained it well. If not, like, you guys can ask me anytime. So I will explain it later, moving into the video, how to, I have clips of it, how to get value from, like, use the water seal pool normally, because the air seal route is really bad. Don't even waste globals on it. Lightning seal one is, I don't think you can afford it right now. I mean, if the meta slows a bit down, yes, you will afford it, but right now I don't think so. Okay, let's move on. I think that was all for the PvP talents. So let's move on the best stats right now for PvP. Overall, versatility is just the best by far. So you will want versatility on every item. Versatility will increase your damage and healing done, and then it will decrease the damage you take as well. So yeah, I think everyone knows how it works. The next best stat, the second best stat, is mastery. Mastery, what it does basically is you will heal more if the target you're healing is like low and low and low and lower HP, you know. So if the guy is 10% HP, you will heal more than if he's 60% HP. That's how it works. Then after Versa first, Mastery second. After that, I kinda like to go crit. But at the same time, I like to have some haste cap. So when I play on tournament servers, I kinda like to have like between 3% to 5% haste. Just because kinda on tournaments you face mages a lot, okay? And mages, they go full haste Versa, I believe. So their globals are faster than your globals. So if you, let's say you wanna kick a polymorph, you kick a polymorph, he fakes you, and if you're in a global, you won't have time to press ground into the polymorph. And that's why I kinda like to have a bit more of haste instead of having zero, because haste for Rosa Shaman is really, really bad. You don't need it at all. But I kinda like it into mages, so I don't get in that situation that often, and I have time to ground. It still happens though, because obviously mages have like between 20 and 25 or even more percent of Versa. So it's gonna happen no matter what, because you're not gonna focus on haste. There is no way, you won't heal for anything. And yeah, so just go full Versa, go full mastery. PvP wise, there is not a lot of pieces with Versa mastery. There is like, I think 5 pieces or 6 pieces without Versa mastery, like the shield, like the helmet, the shoulders, I believe. Then you have gloves as well, belt, legs as well, and one ring. So start to focus on crit a bit, and I don't know. I just like to run a bit of haste, because what I explained before, used to don't get in that situation that often into mages, that they will get me in a global and I won't be able to ground. You know what I mean? Okay, let's move on. Okay, wait, one second, I forgot. The kind of percentage that I would like to have, like on tournament server, I'm full gear there, so if I remember, I believe I have 80% mastery, like 32% Versa, and I think it was 11 or 12% crit, and then like 3% haste. I think that's the perfect stats you can have right now. You get full gear. So yeah, like mastery is really important on Shaman right now. There is so much damage and you kinda need the healing. Okay, Covenant. Covenant, 99% of the times you will play Necrolord. I think it's just too important to don't play it. Just because of this. Ultimate form is just too OP to not play it. Astros to Shaman is just so OP. That's all. And Necrolord actually gives you as well, gives you two abilities, Fleshcraft, that while you're casted, as long as you are casting, the shield is gonna get bigger and bigger till you finish the cast. And in the end, you're gonna get a shield for 2 minutes that you cannot get purged, and it's gonna be equivalent for like 40% of your HP. So you have more HP, the shield will be bigger and bigger and bigger. That's how it works. While you're casting the shield, you are taking 20% less damage. So you combine it without a mastery. While you're casting it, you want to take 20% less damage. And that's really important. Because let's say you, people are training you. You can aura mastery, fleshcraft, you can do it while moving, no problem. And you will take 20% less damage during the cast. That's really important and that's really huge. And people will think, okay, but won't they be... Okay, so you use aura mastery, Spirit Walker Grace with the Ancestral Gift Talent, plus fleshcraft, won't the enemy be able to like stop the cast? With a stun, with a fear, with a blind, with a dragon breath, whatever. Yeah, and that's where ultimate form comes, and it's like while you are casting, while you're channeling Freshcraft, you are immune to CC, and you regenerate 2% of your HP every 2 seconds. Plus, if you finish the full channel, you gain 3 seconds of CC immunity. And as well, you gain the 2% HP every 1 second. So you will have, if the cast, I believe, is 3 seconds. I believe it was 3 seconds, right? Where the fuck is it? Okay, I cannot find it right now. Oh yeah, it's 3 seconds. 3 seconds of a cast. You will get 3 seconds of immunity to any CC. Plus, after that, you will get another 3 seconds. So that's overall 6 seconds of immunity for CC. So if you aura mastery plus fleshcraft, nobody can stop the fleshcraft. So you will be immune to CC for like 6 seconds. So that's really important to know because actually it's the same city. So it's 2 minutes for Spirit Walker Grace and it's 2 minutes for fleshcraft. So you can combine them really good to like avoid CC or anything. Conduits and solvents. Let's move on. Overall, I think like 99.9% of the times you will play Marillet. I think Marillet is just the best overall just because of this. Ultimate form is just so OP in PvP. It's not even close. Like maybe you will get like some value from the others. Like getting some intellect here is not bad. I actually don't even know how this is gonna work because nobody can test it yet, I believe. Actually, this week people will be able to test it. So we'll see. But I don't think it's gonna do too much. I really don't think so. And if it does, I will update the guide as well. We'll see. But for now, you will play Marillet no matter what, just because of this Soulbind ultimate form that, as I said, like. Before, it just gives you an insane immunity to CC during the channeling, and after finish the channeling, you get another 3 seconds of immunity to CC. So it's really, really, really huge. About conduits, okay. Potency slots, you will play always 100% of the times Embrace of Earth, the Airshield Soulbind, Airshield. Airshield increase your healing down to the target by an additional 7%. So if it was, I believe Airshield, where the fuck is Airshield? I think it's here. I think I'm a bit blind. Okay, it's here. So right now it says that the Airshield increase your healing on the guy that has Airshield by 27%. It's 20% plus the 7%, so it's 27 right now. So without the conduit. Well, I actually, I'm not sure right now if it's already implemented there. I actually don't remember exactly if it's like this 27 plus, I think it is. I believe it was 20%, yeah, plus the 7%, so it's 27% here. Plus this, so this conduit that you get from the PvP vendor with Conquest is really important to have. The other potency you have is Swirling Currents, that is here. Using Healing Stream Totem, increase the healing of your next 3 healing surges, healing waves, or Riptide spells by 26%. And this conduit is 200 item level. So I think we'll go to like 29, I believe, or 28, I don't remember. I believe, or even 30, I don't remember right now, on tournament server. But this one is really important. So, you have two charges of healing stream totem. I have a weak card for it, so every time I healing stream, it says here that I have three, and the timer is going down slowly. So, I press one, I press another one, and I press another one, and it will disappear. And if I press healing stream again, I will have the charges here. So, yeah. That's what it does. Every time you play, press healing stream for the next, I believe it was 15 seconds. For the next, Thomas, it doesn't even say. It's 15 seconds, yeah, it doesn't even say on the tooltip. Your next healing wave, healing surge or riptide, will be, healing will be increased by 26%. Plus, all the healing you get from the Urshiel. So it's really important that you have Urshiel up always on the guy that you're healing. It's really important. That's why people try to push it a lot, because it's really strong. Plus the legendary with it. Okay, that was the potency conduits. Right now you have another spot, another potency conduit spot. Slot, sorry. So I kinda like to play Tumbling Waves. Primordial Wave has a 26% chance to not incur his city, so the city will reset if I'm lucky. Okay, didn't right now because I'm super unlucky. But this one I actually like it a lot, and to be honest, there is no better conduits. I thought about this one, that using healing titorium increase the healing rain of your next healing rain by 95% for 20 seconds, because they kinda buff healing rain dispatch by 20%, but it's not enough. So yeah. I just really think the only one left that is good is this one. That they will reset the city after you use it. And yeah, he uses... That's what he does completely. Okay. You go to this row. Okay, you will be potency here, another potency here. And then... I can... talking about finesse conduits, I kinda like to have this one. That I actually don't have it on right now. I don't know why. I think I have it on the other shaman, but yeah. Finesse, this one, if it's low item level, conduit is not that good. But when you have it like higher item level, I believe it was like 27% speed increase on Ghost Wolf. The problem with it is like 1 minute city, but I played the other day in a tournament game into mages, and I could actually line a ship instantly because the speed was too fast. So I could insta line it. You kind of don't need crippling hex anymore, to be honest. It was this talent, this conduit is really nice when the game is a bit slow, but right now is you don't even have time to cast a hex on a DPS to like reduce his damage, because the meta is just too fucking too fast pace. So overall, finest conduits, I like Totemic Shores and Thunderous Fabs, and I don't think Pause, and I don't think I forgot any single conduit from Finesse. I believe I don't. Yeah, so here I will shop around between these two. Like, if I know I can get target, I will use this one, because this one is really, really good, this Endurance. But if I don't, I will always play this way, and I will have this one here, because I think I changed it, I don't know for what, to be honest, but yeah, I will have this one here, or this one of these two. The cooldown of Tremor Totem, Erbine Totem, and Cap Totem are reduced by 7 seconds. This one is really good, and it's not even full item level conduit. I believe it's like 8 or 29 seconds, the maximum conduit. So, like, you will have Tremor really quick, Erbine and Cap 2 as well. So it's really important on Tremor and Erbine, because you kind of use them a lot. What else? And then the Endurance Totem, Endurance Conduits. If I know I'm gonna get hit, I will play like this. This one is mandatory. This Endurance Conduit is really, really, really good. Your Earth Elemental increases your maximum SP by 26%. I believe it's like 30% on the maximum conduit. I don't remember exactly the percentage, but I think it was around 30%. So this is insane. why this is insane, because let's say you're not playing Earth Elemental Legendary, so you can do like some wombo combo that I will explain right now. I don't know if you guys remember, like I talked about it 20 minutes ago, that will increase my HP with Ancestral Vigor to increase the HP of my Fleshcraft shield. So I can combine Earth Elemental to get more HP. With Ancestral Vigor, I have 70k HP and then I Fleshcraft. So the shield is gonna be bigger right now. 39k, and now I can cancel, I can swap the talent, or I can cancel my elemental and the shield is gonna be the same still. You can combine that as well with the emblem, but you need to don't replace it. So you have emblem on, and then you swap it, the Fleshcraft just cancels as you can see. So you need to be careful with that, because they change it. What else? Okay, so yeah, this is mandatory. This one, as I said, like, it doesn't do that many. It doesn't. I mean, it's really insane if they go you, but it's really weird that they train you. And you will have time to cast, maybe without a mastery, but yeah. This one is really good. And the condensed anima sphere. This one, when you take any damage, heal for 3.5% of your maximum HP. This can happen once every 10 seconds. This one is really, really, really good. It's really insane. I actually like it. And I tested it the other day. And if you get trained the whole game, it does like 4 to 5% of your healing. And that's actually a lot. When it's like maximum conduit. Because I tested on the tournament server. Okay, and I think that's all for the conduits. I don't think I forgot any good conduit. I really don't think so. Maybe I don't have any. I'm gonna double check on the tournament server quick. In case we forgot something. And now we're gonna talk about the legendaries. That's gonna be quick one. Let me double check the conduits. I don't think I forgot anything. One sec. We didn't. No, we didn't. Everything is alright. Okay, talking about the legendaries right now. Last season before 9.1, you kinda only used the one legendary, and it was the how was it called? Earthen Harmony. The Earthshield Legendary. I'm gonna read it for you guys. Earthshield healing is increased by 150%. If your Earthshield target is below 75% HP. So the healing. I read it wrong. Earthshield healing is increased by 150% if your Earthshield target is below 75% HP. And healing wave adds a stack of Earthshield to your target to up to 9 maximum stacks. So what this legendary does basically is just, if your full HP doesn't do anything. So if I drop HP now and I'm below 75%, and they proc one stack of it, it will heal 150 more. 150% more. Only if I'm below 75% HP. And as well with the stacks. So if they proc a stack and you cast a healing wave below 75% HP, it will give one stack to the Earthshield. So if you have seven stacks and you healing wave below 75% HP, it will have 8. That's all it does. It's really easy to understand. And yeah, normally if you wanna be super, you wanna min max a lot, you kinda will let your target, the target you're healing drop below 75% HP, so the Earthshield heals for free and you won't spend that much mana. That's really, really hard to do because the game is just too fast, and if you let the guy drop to 75% HP, he can randomly die from like wins from red, from the warrior, from a rogue, from a mage, you know, or you can get CC from a feral, from a hunter instantly, you know, can be really scary. But yeah, if you want to min max, you can do it. Let's say in a match, I mean, the double melee versus double melee, you can kind of do it to like save some mana, just to let him drop below 75% HP, and then you heal there. You will proc as well the mastery, that you will heal more as well. But yeah, that's really min max. Okay, let's talk about the other legendary. I have it on the pump spec. So Earth Elemental has a permanent earthquake on it. So what it does basically is that it has okay, I have an Isidro right now. But the earth elemental will have an earthquake around him, and it will do damage to all the people that are near to him. That's how it works. And it's just the it lasts for like 1 minute. That's all it does. I'm gonna drop it in a second on this dummies, and that's all. Look. For some reason, I cannot. There is like a kind of bug right now on the air delay that, depending on the textures of the map or the textures of the zone, you cannot see the earthquake. But as you can see, like, it's pumping damage. Look at this damage, you know? Like, doing 1.5k normal hits and 3k crits. So, if people stack around it, it's a really big problem, actually. So, people need to be careful of it. He has 72k HP, almost 73k. So killing it is kinda not an option. It can happen though, but really weird. And you can heal it as well in case people are killing it. You wanna be super tryhard. How do you move it? So you move it kinda by attacking flame shocks, spamming frost shocks. You know, look at the Erdel is moving. I frost shock this guy. Let's see. It takes. Look, a flame shock is moving again. And I cannot move it anymore because it disappeared, but yeah, it kind of moves with flame shocks. Doesn't say anywhere, but yeah. Kind of move with the spamming damage and flame shocks, you know? And that's all about the lane. That is, when do I will play each other? Overall, it depends on the comp you're playing, to be honest. I like to play Erdele in 2v2. The Erdele lane that in 2v2, to be honest. I think it's really good. Because all the damage it does, like with the dampening as well, is like you have another player in the game. So it's like 3 versus 2. It's kind of like cheating sometimes. The only problem that I see with it is that into comps that have CC, Roots, Novas, Fears, it's a bit aids. Like, let's say you're facing a mage or a priest, the priest can fear it. You cannot tremor the pet, the earth elemental. You can dispel it though. But you cannot tremor it, and that's the problem that I see. Into mages, I kinda dispel them. Because, trust me, let's say you're facing a mage with a priest in choose, and the Erdele gets Nova. Gets Nova or gets Fear, and your DPS gets Fear too. Trust me, dispel the Erdele. It has more value than your DPS. Unless your DPS is a red and is popping wins, then sure, dispel the red. But otherwise, dispel the Erdele. Trust me, it is worth. It is worth. Let your DPS get CC, but dispel your Erdele. If you play the legendary, of course. If you don't play it, you of course help your teammate. And yeah, in 2v2 I kinda play it a lot. The only matchups that I don't play it is I don't like playing it into like hunters. Hunters, let's say it's Hunter Resto Druid, I kinda don't like playing it. Because the druid has so high healing that he can root it. His healing output is just too high that he's not gonna help. And kinda need the Ursi legendary just to keep up with the damage BM Hunter doesn't choose or Survival Hunter doesn't choose. So yeah, into Windwalkers, it actually depends what comp you're playing in choose as well. But let's say I'm playing Demon Hunter as to Shaman, that's the comp that I play the most. I kinda don't like to play Erdele because they will kinda always go mid with Windwalkers, and without the Ursi legendary, it's really hard to keep up because Windwalkers kinda counter a bit the rest of summons you choose. Unless you're playing with a warrior or another Windwalker, then yeah, it's different. But yeah, I kinda like oh, overall, I kinda like more Ursi legendary. It's more like a safetiness legendary. The Erdele one is just really good to like go all in, or like every 5 minutes to go all in and fuck it, we don't heal, we just go try to kill with everything, you know. In 2v2, I recommend it actually, so I recommend you to crafter if you are a 2v2 player. It's really insane. I play it 90% of the times, but in 3v3, it depends. I will kinda only play it if you play like a melee cleave, let's say Windwalker DK, TSG, Windwalker Warrior, what else? I kinda play it sometimes when I play Warrior Shadow Priest, but not that much. Not that much, it depends into what. Because Sercil is still really insane. So in 3v3, 90. It depends about the comp you're playing, to be honest. It really depends. So you can ask me in the comments, hey Lontar, I'm playing this comp, what lane there should I play into this? You put me in a specific scenario, I can tell you, okay, I play this. I will tell you I play this as this comp into this, you know, I will help you no matter what. So you can ask me anytime on my Twitch channel or my Twitter or Discord or whatever. It's really hard to tell you what to play right now without knowing the matchup. So yeah, overall I kinda like Ersil more, but in 2v2 I like Earth Elemental more. Macros, I'm gonna try to go quick with this. Let me find the macros. Okay, so I don't have that many macros. I kinda use the arena 1, 2, 3 macros for Windshear and Hex. So let me show you quick. Windshear, cast arena 3 Windshear, and I have it for arena 2 and not for arena 1. With an stop casting, so if I'm casting an ability and I press the arena 1 kick, I will stop my cast to kick it. Simple. Same with Hex. Let me find it real quick to show you. I think I'm a bit blind. No, this is the focus one. I cannot find them right now. Oh, is they are there, sorry. So this is the same, cast arena 1, Hex, simple. With arena 2 and arena 3. Simple. What more macros do I have? I kinda have this one that I do it for the link to. So the cursor for the Earthen Wall Totem, so I use Earthen on my cursor, you know? This is really good when you have to trinket and press insta, you know, like I did. I don't have to double click, you know, like this. So, for example, for Airbind, I don't have it because I want to see the range. In case I want to stop drinks or I want to root someone behind pillar, you know. Because if you have it with cursor, maybe you're not in range and you press it, you know. So with Cap Totem, Airbind, and root, I don't have the cursor macro. For the other totems, I do. Kinda have focus hex macro, simple macro, and I made new macros this patch. Actually, I have this one from the last patch to focus the to focus the arena 1, to focus arena 2, and to focus arena 3. That the focus is this one, you know. But I make new macros this patch, and it's the arena 1, 2, 3 Unleash Shield. So the only problem the Unleash Shield has, to use it quick, is that apart from that you need to have like your shield up on yourself, is that you kinda had to target the guy before, so you cannot use it on your teammates. You can only use it on enemies, so you kinda need the macros for arena 1, arena 2, arena 3, or you need to be fast at targeting the enemies. That's all. So I just made that arena 1, 2, 3 macro for it. I remember 1 month ago, these macros didn't work, so you had to target the guy and then press Unleash Shield. But right now the macros work, so you can make a focus one, or arena 1, arena 2, arena 3. I recommend this macro so much, it will save you so much time, because otherwise you will have to target the guy and press Unleash Shield. And with this you wanna... Oops, I think I removed it. And with this you will save a lot of time. Like a lot of time. Let me see if I put it correctly before I feed. Okay, what else, boys? Healing rotation in PvP. Okay, this is gonna be fast, I think. So the normal healing rotation as Resto Shaman is just, let's say they are training me, important having Ersil up always, because the Ersil will do 27% more healing, as we said before. Then let's say the enemy team has kicks and you cannot cast, so remember you have double Riptide. Important, before you Riptide, try to use one healing stream to proc the conduct that we talked before to heal more with it. So you press one Riptide, then you can press Unleash Shield to buff the next ability, and then you can press another Riptide with the conduct as well. And that's kinda all. If there is high burst situations, Of course, you can trade a cooldown, Earthen, you can wall, Ascendance, blah blah blah. Earthen let to get more HP to be more tanky, Fleshcraft without a mastery. You can link as well, you know, whatever. But in terms of healing rotation, you can kinda like Unleash Shield, use your Blood Racial with Healing Stream up, Urshield up, and then Healing Surge. 18k non-crit, that's not bad at all. And repeat. Remember to have a healing stream up for stacks and cast. Stun, stack and cast. Stun and cast, you know? Try to like unleash shield. You have unleash shield before you do a heal. Try to do it. So you want. Try to always use unleash to buff your next shield. Always. Don't try to hold it too much. It's really important ability. Only 14 or. No, only 15 second CD. So try to like use it kind of on cooldown. It's really important. Look, I crit now. As well, when you're casting healing surge a lot on yourself or healing wave, try to have a tidal waves stack on yourself that you get from Riptide. You know, you can only have two, so you get more crit on healing surge or more cast speed on healing wave. You know, but yeah, that's all. What do you do? A lot. I got this question a lot on my stream. What do you do if you are low HP? What is the first ability you press? So let's say, okay, wait a minute. Let me drop a bit lower before, in case I die right now. Just wait. Okay, let's say I'm like 10% HP, like I am right now. I think it's like 10%. And you have already Urshield on the guy, on yourself, on the other partner, whatever. Let's say you have this already. So the first goal that you should press is Unleash Shield. Because look, 20k crit, because the guy is low HP, mastery effects, okay? People, so you have to choose an ability. You have Urshield up already. It's always gonna be Unleash Shield. Unleash Shield, and then you do Unleash Shield. Unleash Shield, sorry. Unleash Life into Riptide. That guy is, the guy is low HP. Let's say you are low HP without the Urshield. Let's hope I don't die. Okay. If the guy is low HP and you don't have Urshield, it depends. So if they have execute or they have a lot big damage still. Like let's say it's a red paladin with wings or a warrior that can execute. And let's say you don't have Link, you don't have Erden, healing rotation wise, you will still Unleash Life, and if the HP is not going down too much, you will Urshield after one healing stream and then Riptide again. I'm gonna repeat it, okay? So if I'm low HP or the guy is low HP and you know he's gonna die because he's a red that can like kill you because he has wings up, or they're gonna get the warrior's gonna execute or the hunter's gonna execute, whatever. You're not gonna Urshield the guy when he's 5% HP. You're gonna Unleash Shield. Then when he's a bit more higher speed, you will Urshield, and then you will rip healing stream if you have time, and then Riptide. That's how will you do, how you will do it. Okay, let's move on. I think that's all. Best comps for Roster Shaman 2v2 and 3v3. Best comps for 2v2 for Roster Shaman. Right now I'm not playing that much 2v2, but the I really think Windwalker Roster Shaman is really, really strong in twos right now. I think it's probably one of the best. Probably Roster Shaman Azarok, that's good. And probably Demon Hunter Roster Shaman is really good too. But overall, I think Windwalker Roster Shaman is the best combo in 2v2 for Roster Shaman. And for 3v3, I'm kinda pumping with the Warrior Espy Roster Shaman. Let me show you. Kinda pumping with it, not gonna lie, we were pumping a lot. I play like some red warrior as well, so I really think best comp for Roster Shaman, probably red warrior Roster Shaman is the best. With warrior SP and I believe TSZ as well. TSZ is warrior DK, frost DK. The Covenant, you play red warrior, you can play Kirian, you can play any, to be honest, Kirian, Benthir, or. You can play any, to be honest, but the best comps are just Red Warrior, Warrior SP, and I think TSZ. Windwalker Warrior is really good too, but I didn't play it yet, so I cannot recommend it. But these three, I do. They are really insane. Cooldown management. Okay. How to press your cooldowns on Rush to Shaman? Like, let's say, as I said, example was your Rogue Mage. Let's say you're playing 2v2. Let's say we're a Windwalker. So, you kinda want to save your trinket for your Link into CC comps like Rogue Mage, Jungle. I think that's all. That's the two comps that Jungle is Hunter, Feral Priest for people that don't know. So into these comps, like, you kinda need your trinket for the Link. It's different city because trinket, your medallion is 2 minutes and your Spirit Link Totem is 3 minutes. But you won't get the Link at all without your trinket, without your medallion. Because Rogue Mage or Jungle, they just kinda kill you in that CC chain. So you kinda want to, the first one, you kinda want to, like, combine them together. Okay, so we said cooldown management, sure, yeah. How to use, let's say, Earthen Wall Totem. Earthen Wall Totem, right now, Earthen Wall is not that good anymore because it absorbs like 775 damage from each attack. So if the guy is doing 20k hits, you will only absorb 775, you know? So it's not that huge right now because the meta is super fast. So you kind of want to pop it almost on CD or just preventively before the CC is coming. That's why I have the cursor, so I just do it before CC so I don't have to click it and it takes a bit longer, you know? So kind of want to do it preventively. The Link, as I said, you wanna into CC comes like Romance and Jungle, you wanna combine it with your trinket. Let's say they're going you. Let's say they're training you. An Astral Gift is really huge. It's a 40% wall on yourself. You kinda want to not waste it. Not waste this CD because it's really important. Like, let's say you're facing Red Water and the Red Water is training you. You kinda don't want to Ancestral Shift before Paladin Big Wins. Okay? Is a 40% less damage taken for 12 seconds. That's kinda like 50% of the red, or 60% of the red Paladin wins. You know, so you kinda want to have this during Paladin wins, or during Combust, or I don't know, or during Windwalker Images, or the Windwalker Swan. So yeah, try to don't use this because try to don't use Ancestral Shift while you are low HP. Because you are low HP, you have other series available. So you are like 20% HP. Just don't trade wall for no reason. If the enemy didn't pop anything, just trade maybe Ascendance, trade or a Link, or a Medallion Trinket, you know, you can trade it. Or a Fleshcraft or a Mastery, so you take less damage and they cannot kick you. But Ancestral Shift, try to trade it to the other people's series if they are training you. And how do you to trade Ascendance? Ascendance is kind of an important CD. The only problem that I see with it is that if you need to use it on your teammates, you need to be 20 yards. It has a 20 yards range, so you need to be close to your partners. So you will expose yourself to get CC. So it depends. The good thing about it, you can use Ascendance while kick. So you get kick into a mage, and your teammate is low HP, so before you get ship, you come close and then you press Ascendance and you top him with it, you know? Or you're coming out of CC and you can Ascendance to top him instead of pressing Link. But as I'm gonna say now, the common mistakes is like, for example, you leave the CC into jungle, for example, and they're popping every city, and instead of checking the Link, instead of using a Spirit Link Totem and saving into an Earthen Wall, maybe you use Ascendance, you try to cast without a Mastery, then you get a random micro CC, then they stop your cast, and then you need to Link anyway. I kinda don't have a clip to show you right now, but as I said, you leave the CC, you Ascendance, you don't top him because there is so much damage going on, Then you use Aura Mastery with Ascendants to try to top him, and you get a Micro CC. And after the Micro CC, you need to link as well, because you didn't link in the first place. So, to be honest, in order of panic situations, I will use Spirit Link Totem always first. Because Ascendance, sure, is a strong cooldown that it will double your healing, it will duplicate your healing. But at the same time, sometimes it's not enough. Unless you get free casting and nobody stops you, yeah, then it's enough. But people kinda save kicks for the healer, for you. So overall, I kinda will use Spirit Link Totem first. And if they go through, they go through, then you press more. You know, but that's kinda... doesn't happen that often that they go through a Spirit Link, maybe another one off. Sure, but that you have to press Ascendance, then you kind of heal the damage, then you have to Spirit Worker Grace, then you have to link after. That's too many CDs, and maybe your partner needs to press another one, you know. As well, right now, Erden is not as important as it was before. But before, when Erden was really good, and it will be good again probably when the meta slowed down a little bit, try to don't use Erden World Totem while your teammates are doing an offensive push. What does this mean? What do I mean with this is, if your team is making a go, let's say I'm playing Red Warrior or Warrior SP or TSG, and they're making a go, and they kinda need to push to their healer, or they need to push to get connect to the mage, the hunter, or whatever, if they need to move, don't use Erden World Totem and tell them don't move, you need to stay here, blah, 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 you know? Because they are doing the counter go, they are pushing to do the go, so they will have to leave the Erden World Totem. So try to don't do it while you are doing the offensive go. Unless you're gonna die no matter what, then yes, you tell them, if you don't stay here, we're gonna die, okay? And that's all. Add-ons. I have a lot of add-ons, but I will recommend you to play big debuffs. It's really huge. It will show you, like, on top of this frame, the CC the guy is on the party frames, it will show you the CC your teammates are on. And yeah, that's all. One more add-ons. I use details. This is this add-on that show you, like, damage, you know, from arena. I don't have any right now because I removed them. You can check damage down, healing down, HPS over healing, key interrupt, CC breaks, mana restore, whatever, you know. It's a really good add-on to check everything that's going on during the arena. I have diminis that I use with S-Arena. S-Arena is this add-on. So I have the enemy arena frames here. It's S-Arena. This one, I recommend it as well. Which one I have? Omnibar. Omnibar is really strong to have because you can track the enemy cities like I have here. Okay, this is a mess right now, but I mean, obviously they're not gonna press all these abilities at the same time, so they won't overlap in 3v3. So yeah, Omnibar is really strong, and I will recommend Omnicity as well. That is the same as Omnibar, but it works for your partners. That you will have, let's see if I can invite someone quick. I show you how it works. So you will see, oops. You will see your teammates' cities. See if I can invite this guy quick. No, this guy's in group. Ah, it's fine. So on this party frame, you will see he has wall, he has kick, trinket, blah, 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 you know, you will see everything there, you know what I mean? That's how Omnicity works. You will see your partner defensive cities on the frame, on the left or the right of the party frame, you know? And I think that's all about the add-ons. I don't think I recommend more for arena. I don't think I forgot anything. Okay, and now we're gonna go into the tips that I can give you to play as a Shaman and to, like, get better on it. So, important one, how to move as Rest of Shaman if you're getting trained. Let's say you're getting trained by a double melee, because it's really weird that you get trained by... I mean, you can get trained by Rogue Mage all game, Azarok, Fire Mage, you know? So, let's say you're getting trained by double melee and you're playing melee cliff, okay? Let's say this is a pillar, okay? You're getting trained right now, so... let me see if I can put marks, actually. No, I don't know what to put marks. It's fine. So let's say you're getting trained. What you want to do, if you're playing double melee into double melee, what you want to do is to go behind the pillar and drag the double melees away from their healer. So what is that gonna do? What are you gonna force doing that? You run in the double melees behind the pillar. If your melees are going on the other ones, it will drag the healer to come closer to the pillar, and that's when we can get CC on the healer, because the other healer will have to come to heal them. Okay? So if I'm getting trained by double melee, my double melee or the people that I'm playing with will try to defend me. So I will try to run away from the other healer, and my teammates will defend me, so I just run behind the pillar, so the other healer cannot heal him through the pillar. So he needs to come closer, and that's when we can engage CC or swap on the shaman, or I mean the shaman, on the healer, you know. But let's say I'm getting trained by a double melee, but I'm playing with double caster, okay, or one caster and one melee. I cannot do that. Why? Because the caster is gonna be in open area, where the other healer is probably there. So I cannot run behind the pillar with the double melees. Why? Because if I run behind the pillar with the double melees, okay, I'm lining the other healer, so the melees are not getting healed, but I'm lining my caster guy or my double caster people, and they cannot help me or anything. So I kinda need to be on his line. What else are you supposed to do? You kinda want, depending on the map, you kinda want to run away from the other healer, but without lining your DPSs, your caster DPSs, okay? So you want to like run away from the healer, but not not behind pillars, you know what I mean? So at the same time, your DPSs can do damage, can help you, and as well, while you run away from the other healer, the healer will move to try to heal the people that are training you, and at the same time, it's getting exposed in the middle of the map, and you will be able to hit the guy. I explained it really well. If not, you can always ask me in the comments about it. I don't mind answering 20 times if needed, but I think you guys understood what I said. How to use Unleash Shield talent, okay? I have a clip here that I need to find the minute of it. 10 minutes, okay. Let me find it quick. It was the 10 minutes, okay. So wait, I wanna show it slowly. So this comp is Red Warrior Resto Shaman into Resto Shaman Windwalker Warrior, okay? What talents do I play here? I don't play Grounding Totem. Why I don't play Grounding Totem? Because there is nothing to ground, only maybe Hex from the Shaman or Windshear, you know? Maybe a Maladic, but these teams kinda don't play Maladic. They should not play because we have so many stops, you know? So I'm playing Lee Shield talent, Living Tide for a Healing Tide, and I'm playing Ancestral Gift. So how to use, I kinda use Unleash Shield talent always 100% of the times into double melee comps, because they kinda stack in one target, so you can get so much value from it. So when do I use Unleash Shield talent? It's just when the enemy team is popping cities. I kinda tell, okay, I wanna pull you. I say pull, so I have to Unleash Shield you. I have to Unleash Shield the guy, so I say, I'm gonna pull this guy. So try to don't move. I mean, they already know don't move if I pull. So I'm gonna pull in a sec. I see the monk is popping bats. He popped Kidian. He popped Swain already. He's probably gonna pop images now. The water pops Warbreaker as well. So I told them I'm gonna pull them. So I press Arena 2 Leash Shield. And as you can see the debuff, the guy is doing right now 50% less damage. And meanwhile, and as well, it's really good pull because my DPSs got stunned. Now the monk is coming to try to kill my healing tide, so it's actually not doing damage during the stun. But the warrior, as you can see, is doing 50% less damage on all his cities: Necro Banner, Warbreaker, Avatar, Blue Fury, Racial Insignia. All his cities are getting completely destroyed. Is doing 50% less damage. Look at the HP. They pop every single cooldown And with this pull, they did nothing with it. Look at the damage. They're not doing anything. Right now, if I didn't pull, we'll probably like maybe almost dead. Okay, the pull disappeared there, so the monk actually did so much damage. That's how you kind of pull. That's kind of how you use Unleash Shield with Water Shield. Okay. It's really weird that you use Lightning Shield. I mean, in this map, I could probably do it. But with all the mobility these people have, like a Windwalker sword, I can knock him down, but he's gonna port up. No one, it's a waste of an ability. The warrior is gonna get, is gonna charge up or is gonna leap up, so it doesn't matter too much. Maybe I can knock the shaman down to give him some aids into root downstairs, you know, but normally playing defensive with this talent is just the best option, so that's how I did it. I unleash it on his cities, and that's all. As you can see, the other shaman is doing it too. As you can see, the buff. It's not the best pull because my team is already pop every city, so it's a bit late pull. And my people are running out, as you can see. They see the pull, they run out, and GG. So the pull didn't get that much value. Okay. How to use healing type properly. This is really important. Is really, really important, okay? What minute is it? Sorry. 43:39. Let me find it out. 43:39. Okay, so we're playing the same comp. Let me find it quick. Okay. So I have healing tide ready. We're playing in the Blade Edge map. So in this map, you can actually into this kind of comms that you have time to jump down and everything. Look, I'm like, okay, there is damage coming. We are kind of fine, so I have time to do it. So I'm just gonna go down. I wanna make sure I move my camera correctly. So I put the healing tide on top of the pillar. Look how I move the camera now. Move the camera like this. So the healing tide is on top of the wall. And a healing tide there. This healing tide is perfect. It's elemental cities. The only problem that I see with this healing tide is actually no, they're in range from the for the healing. So this one is really good. Like I counter the whole go by just jumping downstairs and pressing healing tide. So like the positioning of your totems that we're gonna talk about really soon is really important in this meta. It was before, but right now with the new healing tide is even better. So you can see we're getting heal pump with it, so yeah. How to play versus BM hunters, pet classes, okay. I think I have a clip here of... what you need to do into Windwalkers or BM hunters, how to use your roots. What minute was it? 1 hour and 4 minutes. Okay, so look, I got inked by the monk. As you can see, the monk pop his Shuan. As you can see, I think you can see the Shuan, the tiger. He pop his images, and the rest of someone pop the Earthquake, Earth Elemental Legendary. So, what is my next global after the incap? Look at this. I root all the crap. I root every single pet, and that's how you counter Windwalkers and Beam Hunters. You need to root their pets. Into Windwalkers, you need to root them on cooldown, okay? So you see the images or you see the Swen, insta-root. Doesn't matter, just insta-do it, okay? Insta-do it. But into Beam Hunters, I kinda don't have a clip right now, but into Beam Hunters, you don't want to root on CD. You want to root just when he uses the cities. The Bestial Wrath. Once he uses cities, you go, press Airgraph, and root the pets. And the hunter gets completely destroyed. He can't do anything. Maybe he can freedom the pet. He can press freedom on one pet, but the other one is not doing anything, you know? And that's all. And he actually does nothing with it. That's how you play into these kind of classes. And now, totem placement positioning. Okay, let's watch this clip quick. And then I show you how totem works. Okay, wait a second. I don't know what the fuck did I do here. Okay, for example here. Let me go back a bit. As you can see, I'm placing the healing stream behind. I will explain you how to do it right now. But for example, now I use this grounding is really annoying for the mage. Okay, it's behind the pillar because I turned my camera a bit to the other way around. Because if I didn't, the grounding will be on mage line and it will be killed, you know. But I saw you anywhere right now. So how do you place your totems? Okay, let's try to like find a small pillar. Let's say this one. Okay. So the order of the totem is like the top left. There is only one totem that is gonna spawn there, and it's Tremor Totem. Okay, Tremor Totem always will spawn on the top left of your character. On the bottom left is gonna be always grounding. And on the bottom right is gonna be always your healing totem. So healing stream and healing tide, as you can see, okay? So in this meta, it's really important, okay, to like position your totems correctly. So let's say you want to cast into a mage or into a lock or into a caster, you know, and you want them to not kill your grounding. So this is a pillar, and you know the grounding totem is on the bottom left. So what you do is you tune your camera like this quick. Okay, that's troll because of this pillar. But sure, you will never spawn there, obviously. But for example, I will do it with Tremor because Tremor was top left. Let me find a different pillar so this doesn't happen again, bro. Let's go here. It's fine. Let's say this is my pillar. Bottom left, I tune the camera like this, Tremor is behind the pillar, and then I go out. And the priest, or the warrior, or the SP, I mean, or, yeah, or the lock cannot fear me because the Tremor is behind the pillar. What with grounding? Grounding spawns bottom left, so I turn my camera like this. Grounding is behind the pillar, so I can cast, as you can see, no? What about my other totems? If I want to healing tide go, I turn my camera like this. Okay, so the camera is like this. Okay, I have it in 5, okay? I show you. You will get it, you will do this by practicing, okay? It's not that hard. So you're playing the game, blah, blah, blah. You want, okay, you know there is coming CC, so I tune the camera like this. And the healing tree is behind the, yeah, it's a bit behind. It's just this pillar is a bit, aged, you know? So you need to move, you want to put the healing tree behind the pillar, you move the camera like this. Grounding, you do it like this. Tremor, you do it like this. You know, you kinda need to know where every totem spawns. So we're gonna repeat it again. Healing stream, healing the totem, bottom right. Tremor totem, top left, and grounding totem, bottom left. That's how it works. And how to respond versus high burst situations. Red, mages, rogue, elemental summons. So let's go for the easiest one. Let's say you're facing elemental summon or a mage. Let's say the elemental summon pops Stormkeeper with Echo and Shock. So it's simple. You go to, remember, grounding has, I believe it was 30 yards range. I don't know if it even says. Does it even say? On the tooltip. If he does, I'm blind right now because I cannot see. Okay, I believe it's 30 yards range or 25. I don't think it even says. No, it doesn't say, but I believe it's like 30 yards range. So it's not that much. It's a lot, but at the same time it's not. So you need to make sure you're in range, and then you can, to get more range, you can turn your camera like this. And yeah, when the elemental is popping Stormkeeper or Echo and Shock with Lava Burst or Air Shock, you press your grounding and you completely deny the elemental go. With mages, the same. They pop Combustion and you press Grounding Totem. Simple. Into, we were talking about Reds. Say Reds. That is, Reds is one of the classes with mages, elemental summons, rogues, that they can actually 100 to 0 you in 2 to 3 seconds. You need to track red paladin wins and divine toll. Divine toll is the Kirin ability. So if he gets good RNG, he will like throw like 5 judgments, probably around 4 to 5 judgments, I believe. And if he has good RNG with crit as well, he probably will 100 to 0 you. So you need to watch out how to respond to that situation. If they are going you, once you see red wins, you are full HP. You're full HP and they don't have stun. You don't need to press anything. You may press an Elder Wand, Elder Wand Totem. But if he pop wins and he has a stun, once you see the guy coming to you, you should press wall probably. Because if you're gonna get stun, it's gonna. And if it's big wins, okay? The long wins, the 20 second wins duration. I think it was 20 or 25 if he plays the other talent. But yeah, if he's playing. If he's using big wins, long wins, you should trade a cooldown and try to run away. You should try to, like, astral shift the go and then run. Because otherwise you will have to trinket and wall and press a lot of CDs. But people cry, oh my god, this class is so OP, man. I died through all my CDs. If you use your CDs when you're 10% HP, doesn't matter if it's a 40% less damage taken, you used it when you was 10% HP. So you're gonna die through, you know what I mean? Try to prevent a bit of damage, you know? It's not easy, but that's how the game works. If you prevent the enemy from killing you, you will never die. So yeah, you see a red running to you with long wins up. Even with the small wins, he can do the same, to be honest, but the window is a bit small, so your partners can help you as well. Try to like use wall, or try to ground the stun from the red and then try to run away. Or maybe use Flesh Crab or a Mastery and he cannot stun you or kick you there. That's really good too. And in the worst case, you can Trinket Link or Ascendance, you know. Or maybe your team is can intervene you, swap. Stuff like this, you know. Into rogues, a bit different though. Because normally rogues, sub rogues, just play with a mage. But let's say you're playing 2v2. Into a rogue with a priest, you should not probably trinket till the rogue press. Let's say the rogue is it depends a lot what the covenant the rogue is playing. If he's playing Benthir, the rogue won't be able to kill you 100 to 0 without pressing Shadow Blades, that is a 3 minute CD, or Flagellation, that is 1.5 minute CD. So with that 2 CDs, the rogue won't kill you 100 to 0. The rogue alone. Of course, if he gets helped by the priest, maybe he can kill you. If he crits, maybe not. It's full RNG. But if the rogue pops Shadow Blaze and Flagellation, bro, insta trinket wall and peace out. No matter what. You are actually going to die if you don't press anything during Shadow Blaze and Flagellation from a Benthir rogue. Let's say the rogue, there are a lot of rogue plays now, they are playing Kyrian rogue. So they don't have the Flagellation, so they have a 45 second CD that they will do a big hit every 45 second CD with big mastery. That's a problem. You will have to trinket no matter what the Shadow Blade go if he pops the Kyrian ability as well. The echoing, how was it called? Let me find it for a second for you guys. Echoing. I think I have it here. 1 second. I guess I don't have it anymore. Beautiful. No, I guess I don't have it. You got removed. Unlucky. But yeah, normally try to take your trinket. If he's not playing with a mage, of course. You need to watch out if the rock pop Shadow Blades. So probably have to trinket during Shadow Blades unless your teammate just helps you. If they help you, maybe you can hold your trinket, maybe not. It will depends with what class the rogue is playing. If he's playing with a mage and he pops combustion, you will probably have to trinket outside the rogue cities. But it's all about your teammates as well. Like if you get stunned, once you get stunned, it's all about your teammates. If your teammate is in CC and the rogue press dance plus Kyrian, you probably have to trinket because the mage with that combust will kill you as well. And if they press combust and you're stunned and your partner is CC, you have to press as well. That's the problem with rogue mage. It's a bit really hard because you just die in stuns and there is nothing you can do. So it's all about rotating trinkets to your partners. Maybe Astral Shift one go. Like, let's say you don't have trinket, your partner gets ships. That means the rogue is on a stun you. So you try to pre-wall, you try to fleshcraft with the ancestral gift talent. You know, it's really situational. But yeah, when to play aggro and when to play defensive. This is just depending on the comp you're playing. To be honest, you kinda want to play offensive as a shaman when you know that you won't lose the game doing that. So let's say you have Trinket, Link, Ascendance, Wall, Erden, you have every single cooldown and your teammates have CDs still, that's the time when where you have to play offensive. If you don't play offensive there, you won't be able to play offensive the whole game. And after that, after maybe your let's say you're playing with a red, after your red doesn't have bubble, or he doesn't have trinket, or your warrior doesn't have trinket, or your shadow priest doesn't have dispersion, that's when you need to watch out and okay, I'm gonna stay max range, I'm gonna heal, I'm gonna try to avoid CC, blah blah blah, you know. That's how the game works. You need to try to read the enemy. So you have the game starts, you can make an offensive go. If you don't kill, just watch out. I have CDs, I can keep going offensive. I don't have CDs, I go back. That's how the game works. Try to wait for your CDs to come out of CD, and that's how the game works. Supporting your partners with grounding CM ports. Okay. Let's see this clip that I found the other day. Control C. One hour. And 9 minutes. Oh, this is the clip that I saw before. I think I misclicked it before, but yeah, it's fine. So, how do I... My team, as you can see, my red is using wins right now. We're doing a go right now, we're doing damage, the mage is barely dying, is actually almost dying. So, okay, we don't have kicks. My warrior doesn't have kick, my red doesn't have kick, the mage blink away, I have grounding and seer, but I'm not on the mage line to kick it, otherwise I will kick it. So what I do here, I ground the ship. And that's how you help your teammates to keep to go offensive and keep them out of CC, you know? I help them and then now I'm probably gonna keep the rogue and try to avoid CC or kick the next polymorph, but they have kicks again, so it shouldn't be... Yeah, that's how you support your teammates to like with your grounding CR. You can press push to try to get alter time away from the mage. You can try to push combustion from the mage, thorns from a resto druid or a boomy or a feral. Like shaman is a really good healer because you have so much utility right now. You have a spiritling totem that's a really good, it's a really important CD, a really strong one. Wins here, you are the only healer with kick right now. If we don't count Prot Paladin, of course. You have Purge. Purge is really strong offensive ability. That I don't know where is it right now. Here one. And it doesn't cost that much mana. It actually doesn't cost mana at all. It's 800 mana, that's nothing. And the grounding is really powerful, the grounding design, because It doesn't only ground one ability. It grounds every single ability for 3 seconds unless you kill the grounding. So it's like the all reflect. The reflect from BFA and Legion, for example, you know? It was Legion. It was BFA, but I don't know about Legion. So, yeah. That's how... that was a quick clip of how to support your teammates with like your grounding. You can like kick a cyclone while your teammates are doing a go and kick a cyclone on the boomy, on the feral, and then you keep your team offensive. You can ground a ship like I did on that clip. You can tremor your team offensive, a fear from a priest while you were training a priest. You can do so much on shaman to help your teammates, you know? Rest of shaman versus maledicts, PvP trinkets. When I say maledicts, I'm referring to this new PvP trinket that what it does, I want to show it again. Is this. It's a 3-minute CD, and you have to channel it. You can do it while moving, and what it does damage, and at the same time, absorbs healing. So, in the end, it's 31k healing absorb. And only the healers can dispel it, or a shadow priest with mass dispel. You can remove it with dwarf racial or dark iron dwarf racial. With a vial from Kyrian, I believe you can too. Or you could, I'm not sure now because they changed the maledict trinket. So, what can you do as Roster Shaman to like avoid this or help your teammates to don't get maledict? So, let's say you're facing rogue mage. You're facing a mage, okay? In 3v3. So what they want to do to get full value from the maledict is just force your dispel, because you can dispel the buff. They force your dispel with a Nova on your DPS, with a Sheep, with a Fear from the Priest, with a Dragon Breath, whatever, CC. So you dispel and then depress it and you cannot dispel it. You can heal it, but not. But it's really hard to heal that because it's a huge absorb. Healing absorb. So what you can do in that situation where the mage already force your dispel is to press grounding, but you need to be in range. So even if the absorb is already there, but it's only like 10k, you can press grounding during mid cast, and you can ground the rest of the trinket. And for the next maledict, they will probably press another maledict, then you will dispel it, and for the other one you won't have anything, because you won't have grounding or you won't have the spell. So the third one, you probably have to heal through, or press a city, or your teammate can stop it with a stun, a fear, a disorient, a polymorph, or whatever, a silence, or whatever that your teammate is playing, you know what I mean? I actually don't know if silence work, I don't think so. But with a fear, a stun, roar, it works, you know? And that's why I said in the beginning of the guide that Dark Iron Dwarf or Normal Dwarf is really good into maledicts, not only for Shaman, just for every other class. The only problem with it is that if you face a Feral or a Rogue that can train you down like an Asa Rogue, you will just die because the kindness are just too long, the stuns are just too long, because you don't have this passive hardiness. The duration of the stun effects reduced by an additional 20%. You know, that's the only problem. Otherwise, a Dark Iron Dwarf and Normal Dwarf will be way better than Orc right now, if it wasn't because Rogue are meta and Ferals are meta right now. Otherwise, you will play Dwarf or Normal Dwarf. So boys, I think that's all for the guide. This is the first guide that I made, so if you guys have any suggestions or anything, any tips to give me to improve the next guides that I will make in next patches, or other healers that I play, just make sure to put it on the comments. I hope you guys understood everything that I said. I'm sorry for my English is not the greatest. So yeah, I think that's all for today's video, and thanks for watching, and yeah, I hope you guys like it, and I hope if you guys didn't understand anything, just make sure to let me know, so I can explain it in more detail. In case I forgot something, make sure to tell me, okay, and let me know. Thanks for watching, and see you guys next video. Bye bye.